Okay, welcome to today's Water Insight Seminar Series, the last of the semester. I want to quickly turn the mic over to Laura Fowler to make a quick announcement.
Thanks, John. What I wanted to do is just, because we've tried to circulate publication about this, but tomorrow night, if people are interested, there will be a Spring Creek Watershed Forum, and it's sponsored by the Watershed Commission for Spring Creek to talk about local water issues. Water issues in this area have been in the news quite a bit, but what the Watershed Commission is hoping to do is to actually think about sort of next phase of watershed planning. My environmental mediation class from the law school is going to facilitate the discussion. Torin Miller, who's in the back, can raise his hand. One of my students who will be there tomorrow night helping facilitate sort of what are the challenges that we see for the Spring Creek watershed? What do people think the vision might be 10, 15, 50 years in the future? How do we get from A to B, and how much do people want to get involved with watershed planning? This has been highlighted, but this was not caused necessarily by the local Nestle discussions. But it was more the Watershed Commission saying, hey, we're really, really interested in having this broader conversation. So it's a chance for my law students to help facilitate and see what that's like, but it's also a chance really actually for the broader community to have a discussion about water here. If you're interested, let me know. Up forward, it's gone out amongst different media circles, but it is free, open to the public, 6:30 tomorrow night at Central Pennsylvania Institute of Technology. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Sounds interesting. All right, so for those of you who don't know or are online, my name is John Duncan. I'm one of the organizers of this seminar series this semester. So with Heather Gall, Sivan Raj, and Tammy Veith, thanks for attending. And I'd just like to say thanks to ENRI, and a special thank you to Anne-Marie Nachman for organizing and emailing and getting us here together every week this semester. Thanks very much, Anne-Marie. So today I'm really happy to introduce Peter Kleinman, who's the head of the USDA's Agricultural Research Service Local Lab. Pete got all three of his degrees from Cornell University and has been a leader not just on campus of the lab here, but nationally and internationally with a lot of his nutrient management work. So Pete's going to be talking today about things we may have figured out yet, or maybe things we haven't. So thanks so much, Pete. We really appreciate you being here.
Okay, thanks, John, and thanks, folks, for showing up today. This is actually kind of an amalgamation of about four different talks, that as I developed this over the last few weeks, I kept coming across things that I wanted to add, and it was hard to subtract. So there's four parts, and there is a kind of an organization, a rationale behind it, so let me relate that to you. You know, the first is basically, and I'll show these slides in a moment, is basically to say that we're dealing through the perspective of phosphorus for something that is profound and really about humanity. It touches upon us in lots of ways, just like water does. And so this is a water talk, but I'm going to use phosphorus basically as a way of getting into it and connecting the water issues to other things. We'll go to something that's relatively current, talking about Lake Erie and some of the issues that are there. And then I want to bring it back home to things that hopefully for those of you who are working in the Chesapeake Bay Area and on water quality, are pretty familiar issues of basically nutrient accumulation and some of the phosphorus issues that we have here. But I want to connect some things. And one of the things that I want to connect is Penn State, the fact that we're at Penn State, some opportunities that are coming up. There's a multinational group, ENRI, that's interested in working with Penn State on issues related to phosphorus. Very exciting. And then also local trends in our landscapes, things like the emergence of a very large poultry-producing industry in Pennsylvania, what I've in the past derisively referred to as yuppie chickens, but really those yuppie chickens are creating very real rural economic opportunities. And then I'm going to bring it to something profound, and I guess I have a co-conspirator here, but I do want to talk about fertilizer recommendations and nutrient management. And the types of issues that we're working on here are so fundamental that they do bring us back to consider things like what is the basis of our recommendations and what kind of investment have we made? Should we be content with where we are? Should we basically go further? So that's the nature of this talk. I just had pizza, so I'm a little subdued, but I'll kind of get up to speed. But let's start first with the birthday. So, you know, next year is going to be the 50th anniversary of the discovery of phosphorus. So this is something that I've been working on for almost 30 years now since, you know, I was started in grad school. It's been this kind of continual theme in my life and has allowed me to find meaning in the work that I do, even as all I do now is push paper as an administrator. Okay, so I can still kind of connect to this thing. And so phosphorus is important to all. The majority of folks here are probably scientists. This was the first element that was discovered basically by modern science. It wasn't discovered using the kinds of hypotheses that we would generate as scientists. It was intended basically to be a way of finding and then replicating the discovery of the philosopher's stone, which is basically this concept that the alchemists had that you could have a process that would make of kind of base elements rare elements, things like gold. And so Hennig Brandt in Hamburg took a ton of urine, almost literally a ton, so 1,400 gallons of urine, and through a fairly inefficient process, and I'm going to use inefficiency right here as another theme of this talk, was able to distill it down. I had the recipe in the back if you want to replicate it. People have. You can go on the web, and you can find folks that have, and at every stage, he made decisions that were the inefficient decision. So he threw away the salts that, you know, crystallized when he should have kept the salts because that's where most of the phosphorus, but still he was able to get himself about a quarter pound of pee. So he made pee out of pee. That's the pun. And it glowed. So this is white phosphorus, albin phosphorus. And it was, it's really fascinating to get into the history of this because there were folks all around for various motivations, some of them who were the founders of modern science, some of them who were just on the periphery and had various philosophies about humankind and our relationship to larger kind of a universe and discovering what our fundamental spark was. This was the first thing that was there, a substance that glowed that came from the human body. And so what we found over time, they call it cold fire, is that indeed, actually, it does come from the human body, and this is absolutely the fundamental to life. And so it's in just about every major process that you can think of. And so I've got those up there. This is, you know, straight out of biology. It can be from our energy currency to the way that we recreate ourselves, we replicate ourselves to the walls of our cells. It's that. It took about 100 years, but over 100 years, the Brits basically got out of the Germans' processes for refining phosphorus. And they also then related that phosphorus back to bones as a source. And so there are reports of them retrieving bones from the Battle of Waterloo, bringing it back from what's now Belgium to the UK so that they can have fertilizer for their fields. There's a recognition of phosphorus as an important fertilizer element. And so this is where you need to really start when you think about your water issues, which is, what's the source and then what's the cause of that source? And in this case, for phosphorus, the cause really is, and it needs to be seen in our own development, that our use of phosphorus has set up the civilizations that we have to this day. And so we see it emerging in the rationale of, the law of the minimum coming from von Liebig. We learn about this if you take a soil fertility test. And it's one of these fundamental limiting elements that if it is in greatest, if it's restricting, then all else is set aside. That it is the most important thing. We've gotten a little more sophisticated with modern time, and I'll talk about this a little later with bringing in models and things, but still this concept, this univariate kind of concept, that there can be one element out there that is controlling biological systems productivity. Is important. So this is what phosphorus deficiency looks like if you're trying to grow a crop and feed humanity. So you look for the purpling, you get slow growth, and usually it manifests itself very, very early on. And as a result, we like to stick phosphorus in soils. This is a map here coming from Leon Koshian, who is also with ARS. He was formerly with ARS in New York. And it's basically of the world soils and their relative potential to bind the phosphorus that we fertilize them with. So they're the phosphorus retention. And you can see in the red, that's high or very high. And our approach to fertilizing phosphorus, we have to see as one that's worked, but also one that's fundamentally inefficient. We don't feed the plant. We want to grow plants or we want to grow animals.
but we feed the soil. We apply that phosphorus to the soil. And this is so basic that most of us move beyond that. And yet that is the foundation. We're not feeding the plant. We're feeding the plant by feeding the soil. And as a result, you would expect some collateral consequences. And that's what we who are living in the first world, in the developed world, have to deal with. But addressing this issue is at the basis of civilization and of even modern economies. And the favorite one example, of course, is Brazil right here, where Brazil was able to turn around its entire national economy by reclaiming the Cerrado, by reclaiming their savanna region and first growing things like beans and now having much a little more diversified system there. But that was the spark. And so how did they reclaim it? They reclaimed it by liming, and they limed a little bit with, you know, calcium sources, with carbonates, but they lime mostly with phosphorus. So they use phosphorus as a way of tying up aluminum that was in the soil, and also of fertilizing that soil. And so you've got to think first about using this incredible resource to address the fundamental needs of mankind. This isn't just about being wasteful. This is about the first step that we have in being able to create productive and fertile soils. And yet, the fact that we're focused on the soils is itself kind of an inefficient way of going about it. I also want to point out that if you look at areas that haven't been able to overcome this, that these are the areas that are fundamentally kind of quote-unquote underdeveloped. And so the absence of phosphorus in places is an indication of an inequity that we have as humanity, our inability to bring resources to places, our inability to make people self-sufficient. And so as we think about water quality issues, let's start by thinking about the basis of our use for this. So what we've done, our approach basically has been to overcome the soil's kind of native tendency to bind onto that phosphorus and make it so that it's not available to plant roots that are there. So this is what we call absorption isotherm. This is the, we do this in the lab, it's a batch sorption experiment. We basically take a little soil and we split it out so it's in multiple subsamples, and we expose it to various concentrations of phosphate in solution, shake it for a period of time. All these things are things that we have to control. And then afterwards, we measure how much of that phosphate ended up in the soil, how much stays in solution. That stays in solution is considered the intensity. These are fundamental kind of concepts in soil fertility. So the intensity in solution is basically an indication of the availability of the crop. And then the quantity, which is the quantity that's bound by the soil, is depicted here. And so this intensity and quantity right here explains our approach right now to trying to fertilize crop. We try to increase the amount that's in the soil solution, but we have to feed a heck of a lot to the soil itself in order to get that. So look at the scales here. We have 800 there is the maximum, and 25 here. And so in order to get high concentrations or crop growth, we need to put in orders of magnitude more just to address the soil's phosphorus sorption capacity. And so we move from a soil that looks like this. This would be kind of a native Pennsylvania soil, in which we haven't amended it to change. And we try to change it like this. And the consequence of changing these relationships then is that when we add fertilizer, more of that fertilizer stays in solution, contributes to the intensity, the less of it goes there. So we can become more efficient in delivering the fertilizer to the soil solution, but we've had to put a heck of a lot of phosphorus in the soil for that. And the driving reason for this is that phosphorus is really the ultimate and quote unquote immobile elements, and that's the way we're seeing it. As we go now, you know, it's very, very mobile, and only small amounts need to move to make a problem. But these are just some examples of the let's call them the travel distances for various nutrients in soils, and you can see that really it's right around the root areas where the phosphorus is coming from. Okay, kind of hitting this kind of message home of phosphorus, that the cow nature of phosphorus is the basis for our modern agriculture, or one of the bases of our modern agriculture. This comes from Hannah Poffenberger, who actually applied for a job here about a year ago, and I saw the slide and I asked for it. And it basically shows the green revolution in the United States through the perspective of corn. And
so you've got grain yields, and then you have years over there. And as you move through, you see this trajectory of ever-increasing yields. And they come with certain developments, the technological developments. And so, you know, we're moving from certain varieties to now we're starting to manage the soil better, to we're changing the way that we manage. And now we're in that precision management stage. That's kind of the next set of yield increases that we'll see. And so fertilizer management is right in the middle of the green revolution. And I think everyone recognizes that. So here we have a very successful use of an element, phosphorus. And phosphorus is what Andrew Sharpley calls devilishly useful. And he's just come up with a term recently, and I really liked it. It's that it's in us, and it's got all these uses that are out there, and yet it has these liabilities that kind of emerge. We're going to talk about those liabilities. So here's, this is a depiction. These are all pirated, you know, photos that's taken from the web, so hence the... There's no attribution here, and I apologize. But you know, it's in basically the pizza that we've got. And if you're having your Pepsi over there, it gives this little zing when the Pepsi is coming from the phosphoric acid. So that's in there. We use it in all kinds of things, including in like the glyphosate compound over there. It was originally used in matches as white phosphorus, and they switched over to red phosphorus after. This is also one of these incredible kind of stories. They found all kinds of health consequences. This is a picture of a jaw that had fossy jaw. And so that phosphorus would bind with the calcium and would result in erosion of the jaw. And so you could just Google this and you'll get some horrendous old time, you know, photos of what fossy jaw looked like. But that resulted in some pushback. This coincided with all kinds of changes in industry. It was associated in this case with technologic change where they developed red phosphorus and took away the phosphate jar problem. But then you come up more recently and you think about phosphorus and detergents and its role in the Great Lakes. And you have, you know, starting in the 60s and 70s, really recognizing that our ability to use this element in clean dishes and cleaning clothes was also tied with downstream liabilities. So finally, I get to water. And that is that eutrophication, that the biological enrichment of aquatic systems, is the most pervasive problem that we have for water on the globe. It's the most enduring one. It's pretty much a sign that you've done pretty well with your development, right? If you're dealing with eutrophication issues, it means that you've advanced your development to a point where you have nutrients that are available in excess. But it also happens in places where you find it in paucity. It is a profoundly difficult issue, and a lot of you guys probably work on this. So the poster child right now for eutrophication and the difficulty in dealing with it are the microcystin blooms that are occurring in Western Lake Erie, in the Western Lake Erie Basin. There's been a lot of attention to this. So this, we went out last year went across the lake, and the extent of these blooms in midsummer on a good year with it is profound. You just keep driving and driving in a boat, and you never leave the algal bloom. It would take you half an hour or 45 minutes to get out of an algal bloom area. And these microcystin produces a compound microcystis that is of concern. It can cause all kinds of, you know, ailments, including just the charter boat captains over there all have skin problems. So it's a regular kind of thing just from going out. And they also have a cough that they've developed that right now they're exploring from an epidemiological standpoint. It shut down the drinking water for the city of Toledo, and that pretty much overnight put Lake Erie on the map for a lot of federal agencies, including mine as well. The Lake Erie has three kind of basins, and the western basin, which is where the blooms occur really in the waters, is very much like Chesapeake Bay, very shallow. It's only about, you know, 20, 30 feet deep. And so as a result, it's warm. Turnover time, though, is good. It turns over a few times in a year. So you can move things out of the basin. Here's the story of Lake Erie, and that is it's a dissolved phosphorus story. It's not the old-time particulate phosphorus, sediment-bound phosphorus, you know,
washing off because of poor soil conservation. But it's soluble phosphorus, ending them out there, very small loads, so about 2 kilograms per hectare contributing to the Lake Erie problems here. It represents the reversal of fortune, really. And that, as you can see in the mid-90s, after decades of a reduction in total phosphorus and the dissolved phosphorus concentration loads to the lake, you can see that it starts to tick up. These are two of these are three watersheds right here, the Maumee, Sandusky, and Cuyahoga. Cuyahoga is famously the one that burned, you know, that really helped with our modern environmental ethic and some of our laws in the United States. If you look here at the extent of agriculture, these are dominantly agricultural, the Maumee and Sandusky. Cuyahoga is dominantly, you know, urban and forest. And where you see this increase in the dissolved phosphorus is in the agricultural watershed. You don't see it in the urban and forested watershed itself. And so it's tied to a lot of things, but at the heart of it is basically it's tied to soil. So soil is undoubtedly one of the major sources of phosphorus that we see in our waterways. It's a very difficult source to manage for that. So these are data, they're tile drain monitoring data that come from close colleague Kevin King, who's at the ARS unit in Columbus, Ohio. And all he did was just plot the means and ranges from a couple years of monitoring some of the tile drains again. He now has about 40 different sites that he monitors, and they all end up following on this line. So this is soil test phosphorus in the upper 5 centimeter, upper 2 inches right here. So just right at the surface. And yet it's got a relationship to what's coming down about a meter below from a pipe that's put in there. So you have this relationship. You interpret a lot out of it, but just let's just say generally that the more phosphorus that you get in there, the more phosphorus you lose. You argue about are there inflection points or are there not, and that comes up. Here's the crop response threshold. It's about 50 milligrams per kilogram for the unit that we use in military right there. And so the good news is where you really see the increases is above that crop response. That's not always the case, and Tony Buda can tell you a lot about that in some of our watersheds. So the response has been really to push for what's called the 4R nutrient stewardship. And so this is something that all kinds of folks can hang their hats on. And the 4Rs are the right, so this is all about nutrient management and agriculture, the right source, the right rate, the right time, and the right place. And you can bring technologies, you can educate folks, you can certify folks, and that's what they're doing there. And so they're making advances. The 4Rs largely is addressing today's application of fertilizer. It's maturing over the long term. Maybe we're not going to build up our soil phosphorus at high rates, but it's mostly addressing what we're doing today and not what we did yesterday. So folks want to pin things. Everybody's looking for a bad guy. And early on in the Lake Erie story, no-till came out. And I'll just say right now, this is a story of lots of things. It's not no-till. In fact, a very little permanent no-till, but they have rotational no-till, just like, you know, we have here. And one of the issues with phosphorus is that A, we're not giving it to the plant, but B, we don't stick it down in the plant where the plant grows its roots. We stick it on top of the soil, and then we expect that phosphorus to get down to the roots. And so here's a survey that Laura Johnson did from Heidelberg University, where they went out and sampled soils from all over the Maumee watershed. Again, this is just to remind you, the Maumee and Sandusky were these agricultural watersheds where they had the uptick. Right around the time that they had the uptick in the mid-90s, that was when no-till really started to take off in the area, at least the rotational no-till. So there's a coincidence in the timing here with the expansion of no-till. And in fact, when they went out and did their sampling, what they did was they sampled to various depths. So they went to 20 centimeters or 8 inches. They also sampled to shorter depths. And they found that, and if you can think of each of these as almost simulating tillage, like if you're sampling down to 8 inches right there, that's the same as really effective plow going through and skirting everything up to 8 inches. If you're sampling only to just a couple inches, there are 2 inches. That's the equivalent of only just basically mixing that phosphorus fertilizer in just a couple inches. And so what you start to see is this vertical stratification. This happens very, very quickly. And the highest concentrations are up at the surface. And as I showed in the slide before, those are highly correlated to what we see coming off in tile drainage and surface runoff and all types of things. And so now we have issues of where it is that we're actually applying and where the phosphorus is ending up. So this is source. So again, I gave 50 as kind of that threshold for crop response. And so here you have an average of 36. And by the time you start breaking your samples up, you can see up at the surface, you're above what you need for the crop. It's accumulating right there. The other thing is that you cannot dismiss the role of hydrologic connectivity in the expansion of tile drainage. This is a very interesting phenomenon like here, where it really took off after 2008 when we had commodity prices go through Great Recession. Commodity prices go up through the roof. You have the advent of the tile plow, which is what you see right there, which runs around $40,000, $40,000 to $80,000, depending on how many bells and whistles you get in there. You have farmers or groups of farmers buying these and then basically having to pay them off. And the way they paid them off is by putting in more tile drainage. These are generally poorly drained soils or somewhat poorly drained soils. And so there's a direct correspondence between the intensity of drainage and the productivity that you have there. And so this is very much something that provides a benefit from a production standpoint. And it's been going on continuously. This is also a very, very sensitive topic. So it's hard in those landscapes to really start to think about models that we might have from mental models from our slope landscape. But really, our concept of how phosphorus moves in the environment is based upon the critical source area hypothesis. That is, that there's a limited area of the landscape that's contributing. So this is a Pennsylvania example right here of a mapped up critical source here that are close to the streams, they're connected to the waterway. And this is a hot spot type of a concept. And so we have this, you need a source, you need a way of moving that source, and that's the critical source area. I got more animation in here than I intended. There's also a temporal side to this, the hot moment side, that is really important to understand. That the faster that water moves through the landscape, the more it bypasses the potential sinks that are out there for phosphorus. So these are some, here's a hydrograph from Kevin King of a tile flow. And if you look at the correspondence of phosphorus, you see the peaks and concentration that are there. So it's that quick flow that is very important, as opposed to a slower flow in which you have residence times that promote sorption. And so if you think about the expansion of tile drainage, that really what you're doing is you're increasing those critical source areas, you're providing hydrologic connectivity. And so what I did was just take a Google Earth image where you could see depressions. You can't really see it here with given the light. You can see depressional, internally drained depressional areas. You can imagine putting in pattern drainage on top of that. You're now connecting with this. We can talk about the mechanisms later on but very much what you're doing with tile drainage is you're routing surface runoff through macropores out to ditches or the streams. Okay, so there's lots of finger pointing and everything, but what you need in a landscape in which you're only 2 kilograms per hectare is contributing to the eutrophication, is you need kind of an all of the above approach. So you can look to new things. You can look to bringing in, flapping on drainage water management systems. You can look at filtering, but you also have to look at basic assumptions about how we make fertilizer recommendations. So we'll talk about that a little later. Okay, close to home now. Legacy phosphorus. This is something that Tony and others have written a lot on. This is a map. It's an older map, but they've updated these maps and they've done them on like a Huck 8, and it's not as clear. So it's better to kind of stick to the county level. But you see these hot spots all over the country of phosphorus when you use our ag census data. And a lot of these hot spots you can tie to livestock production. And that's because livestock are, just like we are, relatively inefficient at processing the phosphorus that they're being fed. About two-thirds of it goes out the tailpipe. and then that manure doesn't go very far, stays in those areas. So here you've got this
link between livestock production and phosphorus accumulation, certainly locally. And so that, Pennsylvania's got them.
You can see them over in the east. You can see some on the Delmarva Peninsula. We do a lot of work here, and there's a big poultry industry there.
One of the things that's happening right now in real time is that we've got a lot of poultry barns coming in, particularly in the central Pennsylvania. And this is kind of happening with the TMDL in place. The poultry barns are something that provide an opportunity for small producers who have very little opportunity other than that. Okay, so we were in an era right now where dairy farms are going out of business rapidly. There are reports on local radio about folks who are too small to have their contracts renewed. There's changes. They just can't stand up. The one bright spot is that Pennsylvania is home to Bell and Evans. And Bell and Evans taking advantage of basically people who have expensive tastes, who are willing to pay a little bit for animals that are produced with certain certification of animal welfare, sustainability, strong sustainability push. And so this, I have a small farm, and I just got this from my Ag Choice Farm Credit, where they had a whole kind of case study about couples using, basically their new poultry houses to keep them on the home farm. I had built a barn last year, had four Amish guys come out and build a barn. They said, this is our last barn. We're going back and we're building poultry houses on our operation. They're Amish, so they don't have a lot of land, but we're building this and we're going to just raise poultry for a living. And that's what Matt did when he was a kid, right? That's it. So this is got to be seen both a bit as concern, because we know that on small operations where you're bringing houses that are, these are big houses, raise 250,000 birds in a year in one of these 600-foot houses, they're also going to start to accumulate that the litter locally. You've got to see this, though, as something that's incredibly important in rural areas, to particularly to our producers. But here's what's happened in other places. This is the great state of Maryland next door. And these are average soil tests for farms where the phosphorus index is run. And what you see down in the area where we work on the Eastern Shore, this is right here, is the Chesapeake Bay, is that the average soil test is between 300 and 400 milligrams per kilogram. They use FIV. This is the fertility index value, very similar to that NELIC-3 that I just showed you. In fact, more or less the equivalent. And we're approaching order of magnitude more phosphorus in the soil than what's needed to feed the crops there. And this, it's even worse than you think, because I guess I had just started. I should have been on the cast. So the melanin-free extract that is used here and that we use is buffered at various stages by the soil itself. And so it has, this is like a titration curve. When you get in that 300 to 500 milligrams per kilogram range, melanin-free becomes very inefficient at extracting the phosphorus. So it's not a kind of a linear increase. And so a lot of that phosphorus that it's bringing into solution goes back and gets down by the soil. And so you have to keep adding phosphorus to that soil for a while to break through the 300 to 500 range. And so the total phosphorus in these soils can be between 1,000 milligrams per kilogram and 2,000 milligrams per kilogram. This is just a measure of extractable. So that's the reason I went down that. But anyway, we're in an area. This is the poultry producing area. The whole integration of poultry production and following that swine production owes its origins to the Delmarva. And there's been amazing strides in different areas. So one of them is in that mass balance of what we feed the animals. These are data from a faculty member, I think she's at Maryland. I can't remember if it's Maryland or Delaware, but she's plotted out over time. And here's nitrogen phosphorus. You can see the kind of the amount that's excreted in nitrogen and phosphorus in 1959. And you have advances in the way that we feed them. And you move to the future, and what happened in the late 90s, early 2000s, they had the phytase, which breaks down organic forms of phosphorus, and it's
really helped to reduce the amount of phosphorus that's excreted. So we've gotten much better in terms of the content that's in the litter, but the fact of the matter is we just produce a lot of animals in a small space, and we don't move that byproduct, that manure, very far. And so this is a quote from a farmer that we work with, who right at the end of it, we were talking to him about all these things, about manure management, technologies that we were bringing to bear, and he shook his head. He said, you know, I came to farming to raise animals, and I feel like all I'm doing now is managing manure. That's it. And so, manure really is one of these profound areas for agricultural management. It is a rocky danger field area. It's incredibly important. And yet, it's hard to make economics work around manure crops. So here's what happens when you start off in that 300 to 500 range of military phosphorus. And we put in the early 2000s, we did a drawdown study. We basically stopped fertilizing some soils so that we can remove the phosphorus from the soil and bring that phosphorus hopefully down over time just by exporting it in our harvest of corn and soybeans. And basically over a decade, we didn't move anywhere. And the ditches that we monitored right there essentially stayed at the same water quality the entire time. This dissolved phosphorus. So we came up from these experiments and from some other work with the concept of legacy phosphorus. This is basically phosphorus that's out there in the system that was a result of the habits, the practices of yesteryear and not of today. Other studies have looked at drawdown, and generally what they find is that you can draw that phosphorus down. It's really the rate at which you draw down is dependent on what your starting point is. The more that's in the soil, the longer it takes. But for the most part, at high levels, we're dealing with many decades before we can draw it back down to a level that we would consider reasonable from an agronomic standpoint. Okay, so basic problem is that we don't move manure around, and it's really hard. So we've had all kinds of societal investment in manure management. This is the kind of thing that warms the cockles of Jim Shortle's heart, which is basically trying to bring in cap and trade and innovative markets for that. But here's the Delmarva litter plant. This is in Sebring, Delaware. They invest in the plant that could move 14% of the poultry litter on the Delmarva Peninsula. It's on the eastern shore of Maryland, and Delaware's there, Virginia's there as well. It went out of business 2 years ago. For a while, it was doing well. It was subsidized, but 2 years ago, with no fanfare. In fact, people who work on these issues in Maryland didn't even know that it happened. It went out of business. It's hard to make money off of the door. It's really hard to make money off of it. You can do it. But those models are not ones that are easily scalable. And so we've got other examples. These are, that was massive investment by the Environmental Protection Agency. And this is mandated, the one in Minnesota is mandated by the state that 50% of their turkey litter would be used in a manure to energy project. Right? That one's still working. They produce ash and around. You see, manure digesters, they work, but they work on larger operations. Rough. All about that. In Arkansas, following litigation, where they wanted to move manure around, but the farmers receiving the manure didn't want to just get it when the guys were cleaning the house. They wanted to get it when they needed to apply it to their crops. They were pretty innovative, and they used the balers that we use on round bales, just the plastic wrap on that, and were able to move that around more effectively. So the innovation can happen. It's really hard to move manure around. So we've got manure accumulating in all these places. It's contributing to legacy phosphorus issues. It's very hard to get people to take that seriously because of the fact that our systems are built to account for those particular costs. So enter the issue of peak phosphorus. Okay, and a few years ago, this emerged as a potential driver. It's still there. I want to talk a little bit about this one first. I also want to introduce the company ENRI that Penn State has been hosting and is looking to partner with Penn State. This is a multinational materials company. They were in the mining business in the past, and now they see themselves more as a company that takes raw materials and processes them or finds opportunities for increased efficiencies to move them around. And they're looking to partner with Penn State, looking at basically supply chain types of issues. So here's the use of phosphorus in as fertilizer. You can see it's gone up, up, up. In the about 2009 out of Australia, there was a piece that came out using USGS data. They plotted where the world's finable reserves were and came up with the conclusion that in the mid-2030s, we were going to reach peak phosphorus just like we did peak oil. And this got a lot of folks very excited. And you see response that still continues to this day in Europe. But it also set kind of the timeline. It was almost destined to be disproven. And so peak phosphorus is something that, well, we have a resource that we have to mine, that we get from our mineable sources, or we have to recover from other sources. But the industry went back and looked at the data that USGS had. They also went out and there were new sources, particularly in Morocco. And they went from this assumption that we had in USGS in 2010 to increasing, you know, fourfold the mineable reserves. So suddenly that 2035 date isn't as critical. It's, you know, now we have more in the way of readily available reserves to mine. So they said, oh, we're looking at peak phosphorus actually out in the future, you know, 2300, 2400. And in fact, if you look at the total resource in the world, we have much, much more. And so by the time we get down to 2300, 2400, we'll have new ways that are economically efficient at mining this. So moot point. I don't think it's a moot point at all. It's still the fact that we're reliant upon this resource that right now is very, very cheap. It's just, you know, a few tens of cents a pound of phosphorus to go out and just buy some phosphorus fertilizer for my place. So it's still a very cheap one, but we are dealing with a resource that we extract and we don't really look much at the recovery end of it. There's an aspect of this that touches upon national security and our ability to produce things internally at a national level. If you look at where the reserves of the world are, it's kind of amazing. This has just changed in the last decade. So Morocco was not this big of a piece of the pie, and it's now the majority of it. In fact, OCP, the big Moroccan giant, was here wooing Penn State to work with them on this issue. So Penn State's in this great, great position with regard to phosphorus in particular, and some of the big players that are around there. You look at the United States, and we have 2% of the world's reserve. Our major ones are down in Southeast in Florida and North Carolina. We have others. We've been sitting underneath the Rockies, but it's hard mining, and we're just not tapping into that, you know, quite yet. Okay, so enter the concept of the circular economy. So this, if you can't see this in the back, right now we have kind of a linear system where we go from extraction to use, and then basically whatever doesn't get used is kind of thrown out there. The circular economy concept is one in which we're recycling, we're reusing things. And we construct our economies around that. So pulled this off out of the wastewater literature, kind of a vision for that economy with basically agriculture using the phosphorus. It goes to food, goes for humans, ends up in the sewage treatment plant, and you have all these different recoveries that happen right here. This suggests efficiencies of these various stages, which aren't really there. But, as I described before, you have to really load up agricultural soils in order to produce a certain fraction of in order to get the food out of there. So they work on these technologies. I thought I'd mention this. This is Struvite. So Struvite precipitates a lot of wastewater treatment. Deal with it as a problem. That's what's basically up in there. So it's a source of nitrogen, source of phosphorus, a little bit of magnesium as well. And if you go to Northern Europe, you can go to Berlin, you go to Amsterdam, and you'll see lots of examples of struvite recovery systems coming from wastewater treatment plants in which they actually can produce, you know, fertilizer-grade struvite from there. So it's very encouraging. At the same time, that struvite, which is a pure form, relatively pure form of phosphorus, that can be used directly as a fertilizer, sells for half, twice the price of the same weight of
rock phosphate. And so it's right now the industry just isn't really willing to go whole hog into using struvite, so the demand is not there for struvite. We got systems, we got Alex Christoph in the back right here. We have systems emerging for agricultural manures and the recovery of those. And I think this is one of the great areas. Clint Church is in the back also. This is their unit that it's the Penn State ARS one, which recovers the majority of the phosphate. They have all different ways of kind of recovering that and reusing on the system. These types of systems are ones that right now we're trying to make the economics work. They have the potential for commercialization. They're usually driven by regulation though in order to get there. But we'll see tremendous advances of those over time. And Penn State's right in the middle of it. So here's where I want to kind of do the first of the proposals. And that is, if Penn State is working with, you know, Inverse on issues of kind of supply of phosphorus, that's their concern is with phosphorus. We have a rural economy that takes advantage of few opportunities right now, and Bell and Evans being one of the major ones. But the connection between Bell and Evans, a company with a very, very strong sustainability platform that's right at the heart of what they do, their mission. And Imerys, I think, through Penn State, working on these kind of large cycles, these large system level flows, is one that really needs to be made. And I'm sure probably will be soon. And there's opportunities for folks working in water to be part of that, because that's where the driver is. Otherwise, we're just waiting for phosphorus to run off, and that's not happened in our lifetimes. Okay, so I'm going to finish with fertilizer. I'm sorry if I've kind of gone on. Like I said, I'm blobbing together a number of talks here. But I want to finish with something that's equally profound, and that is looking at the basis of our fertilizer recommendations, and really more modernizing it. So this isn't so much of a failure of what we have or anything, but more that a failure for us to continue to be able to invest in it. So Doug Beagle, I was very close to Doug when we retired, was always running fertilizer response trials with any other type of research that he could do out there. Always trying to add to the data set. Very difficult to go out and get money other than directly from industry for industry-related products to go after fertilizer response. And so it's very hard to move nutrient management along. So one of the things is that every state, every land grant, just like Penn State University, generates its sets of recommendations. And so you have this proliferation of recommendations that they've been harmonized a little bit, but they're hard to relate. So I'm going to give you kind of an example pretty quickly. But these are soil tests from a couple of different places. They could come from private industry, they could come from the land grant. But they're incredibly complex. They're hard to explain to folks, including producers. Most of them are both based upon older data, and those data were lost when the professor left and his filing cabinet was shelved someplace or sent off to the incinerator. And they're very opaque, that the we don't have a way of tapping into them and kind of rediscovering their basis. So I want to give an example from Lake Champlain that emerged just a couple of years ago, where I got a phone call to weigh in on an impending lawsuit that had to do with guidelines from New York and Vermont. And at the heart of it, in the end, was the fact that when you look at the New York recommendations and look at the Vermont recommendations, that at a maximum, the Vermont recommendation can result in roughly twice the applied phosphorus to Vermont soils as the New York one. It gets much more complicated, and this has to do with the fact that there was an advance in Vermont, and they bring aluminum in and the binding capacity of aluminum into it. They're not talking about all the same soils. In fact, this only applies to very, very few soils where you can see that difference. But still, in the recommendations, you have a maximum recommendation of 65 for Pennsylvania and 120 there, and by golly, let's litigate. Because that's got to be at the basis of the Lake Champlain issue, which they have algal blooms that are related to phosphorus too. Okay, so bottom line is that this basically arcane area, by nature of the fact that it is so opaque, is one that opens itself up then to problems when we start dealing with water quality issues and looking at things across geopolitical boundaries, like state lines or international lines.
These here are the various soil tests that are used just in our little, pretty much a non-agricultural, we're not the biggest player in agriculture here, but here's the northeastern set of soil tests that we have. We have Mallet 1, we have Mallet 3, we have Cornell Morgans, we have Modified Morgans, we have three, and then Bray Kurtz, and you go over it into Ohio there. So we have all these soil tests that they're all trying to say something about what's available to the crop, but they're kind of black boxy, and they all have to be compared if at the state line in the end. And they, I don't know if I said that right. You know, they will get compared at the state line in the end, particularly when we have water quality issues driving that comparison. So soil fertility recommendations are not easy to make, and you don't just make it for one crop, you make it for multiple crops. These are fertilizer responsors. This is coming out of the University of Nebraska, where you can see the differences in crops that are in the same rotation. Okay, so if you're basically managing for that crop and you're feeding the soil, you're gonna manage for the wheat crop. You're not gonna change and manage for soybeans 1 year and corn the other year. Plus, you've got all these tests then, so now you have to enter those into that comparison. And so we've got kind of a mess. It's just a big bowl of spaghetti. We also have the issue of, and this is philosophy right now, which is when we set our when we calibrate, we say that we have very low, medium, high, very high phosphorus or whatever in the soil. We do that first through correlation. We correlate crop growth to the amount that we see in the soil. Then we go out and we interpret curves, and we start to break up those curves. And that can be very, very arbitrary. Anybody participating in that process can tell you. So you have that as the as kind of a starting point for uncertainty. Now you add in this whole difference in kind of philosophy. And no soil fertility expert in a land-grant institution wants to be making recommendations in which it's found out later on that they hurt somebody's yield because they didn't advocate for enough of a resource to apply. And so there's the concept of maintenance. So applying more fertilizer than what you need to achieve your 95% crop yield potential, but basically trying to maintain it in the soil because you know the crop's gonna be taking some out of that soil. So that's called the maintenance approach. And that basically dominates our recommendation system worldwide right now. And that's to be contrasted, and this was with a deficiency correction, or what's called the sufficiency approach. And I'm going to explain this very quickly. This is an approach that basically comes from us fertilizing the soil. That approach right there is one that goes and looks at fertilizing the crop.
Okay, so why, how does this emerge in our current context?
It emerges in something as esoteric as land rental, which is incredibly important. So almost 40% of U.S. cropland is rented. In the Lake Erie area, where soil phosphorus is clearly one of the major issues, you've got more than half of that cropland is rented. And the lease agreements will always include soil fertility maintenance component. And so there's a strong push to keep the soil phosphorus levels high in the soil. In fact, that is the reason for canceling a lease, would be if you let that drop down. And so I'll remind you again that you've got that relationship between soil P and runoff P there. It's now entering into the water realm. So here's the tri-state recommendation. So this is for Indiana, Michigan, and Ohio, I think. And they very much have, whenever you see this kind of shared, this is the maintenance approach. So this is the rate of fertilizer application. This is the increasing soil test level. When you're very low in soil test, you basically start applying a lot of phosphorus, and then over time, as your soil test goes up, you can reduce it. You'll get in that range, that maintenance range that I showed before. And then eventually, when you get above that range, you either stop or you apply less fertilizer than that. So that's this is the concept. This is the algorithm that's used in generating recommendations
If you send it to the Ag Analytical Services Laboratory, they have something just like that in there.
So here we go. So this is that first leg right there, the build-up stage, where you're trying to get to the critical, the crop response threshold right there. And that's a maintenance approach. With the sufficiency approach, you're actually not looking to build up the soil. You're looking to basically provide by putting that fertilizer in close proximity to the crop, potentially even by adding some foliar application, that phosphorus to the plant. And so the rates of application for a sufficiency approach are much less than those that are used for a maintenance approach. These are very difficult to persuade folks to do because the economics aren't going to drive it. It's going to be something else that drives that. And that given our current system, if you're going with a true sufficiency approach, those soils are going to appear to be deficient in soil phosphorus. They'll have less phosphorus in them than what a maintenance approach would earn. So that's one issue. We also have the issue of how do we do our testing? They're just little things like how deep do I sample? We calibrate to certain depths. So when you get vertical stratification, that's an issue. These are some really interesting data out of Lake Erie that basically show that surface sample, which is so important for making inferences about runoff phosphorus, doesn't do anything in terms of its correlation to corn yield. But when you look down lower where the crop roots are, then that's where you see that relationship again there. So this is the final call, and I'll kind of wrap it up right there, is that we have precedent and we have initiatives. They've been not been global, that have looked to try to bring soil fertility recommendations back to the fore. And why? Because of transparency. A lot of the recommendations are coming out of the private sector now. They're using proprietary approaches, really around precision management. And so we're losing our kind of our understanding of what's at the basis of the recommendations. There's an argument that the land grant recommendations are not current. They're on all old varieties. They don't use new technologies for applying the fertilizer. That we have very, very localized, very, very focused recommendations. But we need things that are more comprehensive. So there have been attempts in the United States to basically go down the path of the open data base, and this came out of the plant nutrition folks. These guys are actually funded by the fertilizer industry. But they have not been successful. What has been successful in Australia is Better Fertilizer Decisions Database, IPNI, that group that I just referenced, part of that. And basically, they pooled all the data that they could get from their various sources. They worked on a program that ensured that even if you're in the private sector making recommendations, if you want to be certified by this, and now you really need to have any credibility, then you're going to use a certain set of approaches that are approved. That you're not just going to kind of squint your eyes and say, yeah, I think you need to add an extra 50 pounds of phosphorus. That they're actually going to be based upon the analysis of the relationships. It allows them also to query so they can pick for a particular region. And then they have that certification part. It's a wonderful model and one that's kind of just dying to be replicated in the U.S. And I think there's a lot of willingness and interest in going down this route. What parts of that program can we use? So here's the program, and this is something that I hope you can almost organize like an ag school around this. And we need a new investment in our fertilizer recommendations. That includes doing new things, and faculty and students need to be doing new things in order to generate our recommendations. But it also tapping into our existing data and making them transparent and bringing them into systems such as that Australia one that allow transparency, that can be comprehensive, that certainly allows to move from our maintenance type of philosophy to one of sufficiency. So I'm going to end. I'm sorry for running long, but just like I said, I had a lot that I wanted to kind of cover to get to this point. So we're at 350 years of basically a pretty old subject, but a lot of the old issues that are out there are still current for us to this day. And so I hope that they're not seen as things that have already been solved, that they still need to be
tackled with and addressed. We have to live through them. So that's what I got. Thanks.
Got a couple of minutes for questions.
All right. I'm curious if you like the phosphorus tax that you're it's costed millions and millions of dollars. Is there a way or are there discussions about how to bridge that economic disconnect?
This one for Lake Erie is particularly hard. There's always a desire to go there. My reaction now is actually the cynical one, and I shouldn't do that. But it's a very small loss. So losing 2 pounds to the acre of phosphorus is nothing. So that's losing 2 pounds to the acre. That's like 30 cents to the acre of phosphorus lost in a system that can easily kind of absorb that. So at that level, it's hard to articulate, and that's the base of the problem. It's hard to articulate in the economic efficiency behind it. But there are, you know, kind of other systems that you could use in which you're now crediting for the benefit downstream and providing a cost to that. So that would be, you know, the cap and trade type of approach that would pay for practice. And that actually has a very real kind of application to Lake Erie. It's not, you know, been tackled yet. It's a hard one to implement. Pennsylvania has implemented, we've gotten it, and not well. You know, it's a very difficult kind of approach to take something that's certain coming from like a wastewater treatment plant and applying something that's uncertain, like the benefit of a BMP, and coming up with those equivalencies. And so with the Chesapeake, it's been mostly about moving manure out. So you move a lot of phosphorus to the north, but there it it's less of a manure story, it's more of a fertilizer story. And so the margins, you know, aren't kind of as great from that type of philosophy, unless you start to value the individual practice, which I think it can. I just don't know exactly how those economics work out.
Great talk. I remember hearing about some of the modeling that was done for the Midwest states. They're kind of the goal related to the Mississippi River Delta, Gulf of Mexico, that in those modeling exercises, they really didn't find that before our changes did that much. And so they were focused much more on cover crops and saturated buffers and all those other kind of field practices. But you seem to think that, you know, 4R and good nutrient recommendations are critical. So was that more about nitrogen in the Mississippi River Basin?
Well, there's a scale to it that, there's some of it's the models themselves. So the models themselves, particularly for phosphorus, we've worked in this area, a set of processes where they took 4R related things, the soluble phosphorus source that you would bring, and by nature, they didn't want to basically have all that phosphorus available to the crop at one time. So they, even if though it wasn't in the soil, it's sitting on the soil, they simulate that the phosphorus is bound to the soil. And they use soil, basically the sorption isotherm parameters to feed it back. And that's been corrected recently. It dampens the signature of the 4R. So that's the first thing, is that there is a role for that. The second thing is that legacy phosphorus in the end, it's the phosphorus that's out there in the environment. The same sinks that we had that were there yesterday are potentially now sources that are there. And so those can overwhelm that. In Lake Erie, there are practices, or were practices that were commonplace, that were 4R practices that needed to be put aside. And we would not allow that cause Doug Beagle to throw his hat down on the ground. Winter fertilization, so they were surface applying 2 years worth of phosphorus in the dead of the winter on frozen soil, because that's what the one guy operating on 2,000 acres could get out and do that on frozen ground. Basically couldn't go out there in the springtime and things like that. So that's a 4R thing, is not to be there. That wash off is a very real signature, and the Heidelberg folks have shown response to that, so it works. It kind of comes down to all of the above, legacy phosphorus in the end will undermine everything else that is not taken care of. And so you need to start thinking about how do we bring down the amounts of phosphorus that are in our soils that end up in our sediments and can feed our aquatic systems, and so that's a big one. So I don't know if I answered your question kind of fully. I'm a little skeptical about the models themselves, and locally you do see a response to 4R practices, but as you start to scale up, Now you're looking at larger kind of system level. The cover crop, I wish I had the cover crop example. So in Lake Erie, cover crops were pushed right away. Everybody dusts off their agenda and brings it in when there's a problem, right? And so a lot of investment in cover crops. And the folks at Heidelberg took advantage of a couple of EPA watershed programs, did a before and after controlled impact study, and basically found that when the cover crops went in, the dissolved phosphorus concentrations in those watersheds went up. And this is the place where. And that's because cover crops are like a slow release fertilizer, right? That's it. So they're bringing phosphorus out of the soil into the plant tissue. And that plant tissue dies either as a result of senescence or because you're applying an herbicide and you lyse the cell. Remember the second slide that I showed was phosphorus is in everything. So you get a lot of soluble P that's actually in plant tissue. And so that soluble P washes off. And so you get signatures from basically herbicide application. It's not from the herbicide itself, it's actually from the plant tissue. Coming up. And so that's not a panacea either. And it has for soluble phosphorus, it's great for particular phosphorus. For soluble phosphorus in areas that are hydrologically connected, it really is kind of a questionable thing. It's got to be accompanied with other practices. So I basically just waved my hands around and said it's really complicated.
There's a couple of questions online.
Is there any research being conducted about how to adjust key fertilizer recommendations based on the soil health levels and population? So there's a test that is kind of popular in the soil, certain kind of areas of the soil health community, that Solvita or the Haney test there, that folks will argue can be used in making fertilizer recommendations. I'd say that the majority of the soil fertility and plant nutrition community hasn't bought into that, you know, quite yet. But it is an area in which they're trying to make those connections. So the second one is, do you believe there is fundamentally too much P in the system? What do you do with the excess P if it's not needed for land application? Yeah, so that was kind of, the whole talk was around this, was that by nature of us addressing basic needs for humanity, we brought a lot of phosphorus to systems where it was not, and very little phosphorus from an agronomic standpoint can result in a big environmental response, a big impact on our aquatic systems. And so I think some of it is we've just got to live with it, but working with that excess P is one of the, like, I think it's one of the most profound issues that we face, and whether or not we decide we want to recycle it or we just want to squirrel it away so that it's not making a problem locally, you know, that's up to the students that are here to kind of figure that one out.
Okay.
Yeah, Dave.
Question, as we move to a system where we're totally recycling our waste, human or animal, what about the other components of that waste, like the chemicals?
Yeah.
Pharmaceuticals, which is toxics. I was watching WPSU last night. Anybody who watched that might be asking this question. What about the chemicals that are there that we don't know about? We don't test for? It's a cause for concern. I'm all for recycling. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah, that's been a hurdle. So I give work for a while with Chip Elliott and Robin Brandt in the engineering department here. And we wanted to do kind of a simple trial on a cooperator's land. This is a good cooperator. We told him it was biosolids we were applying. And then we found out what biosolids were. He was completely unwilling. And this is, even though they went through a whole process. This is a tough question, right? Because there's emerging contaminants. There are things that are very real that we don't know what the consequence of their presence is. There was a system that was set up to classify biosolids based upon safety and make a risk assessment on that. And so it kind of reflected the best science that was there. That system has allowed for a lot of biosolids to be applied. They tend to be applied at rates much higher, like orders of magnitude higher than what you would manure phosphorus down, but that phosphorus is relatively stabilized, reasons for doing it. And so that does close the cycle, but what do you do with these other things? I think that does, it prevents it. And so you work with the knowledge that you have, and as you find out about them, either you adjust your management recommendations. I'd say conducting larger life cycle analyses and considering multiple sources of risk would be an important research into it. There's a component of this is perception, and people wanting to control for risks at levels that just simply aren't reasonable when you compare with the other things that are out there. And there's a component of this which is very real, and it's got to play out. So I'd say maybe improving those standards for biosolids so that they reflect different contaminants. That might be one area, but it's a wicked problem.
All right, on that note, can we take a moment to thank Pete for a fantastic talk? We may be able to stick around for another couple minutes, but I think we're getting kicked off the line soon. Thanks, everyone.